thank you. What an immense honor it is to be here today. And I'm a professional Farmville gamer. I do it out in the field. And I also help facilitate abundance for orchards and communities. I do that with my fiance, Rob McClure. We're on Hilltop Community Farm, just outside of the sleepy town of Laval, northwest of Madison, where we have a CSA and an orchard. I also consult and teach on topics that range from people, plants, and dirt, my three loves, though not necessarily in that order. So I'm curious, how many of you have a garden? Woo, some hands. How many of you are part of a group or an organization? A few more? Well, how many of you eat? Okay, great, my talk is relevant to everyone. So in the next 12 minutes, I want to share with you what I'm passionate about, offer you a tool for regenerating your gardens and your human relationships, and invite you to co-create the conditions and potential for an abundant, sustainable food system for yourself, your community, and for the world. What I'm passionate about. Well, I think the slide says it all. People, plants, dirt, more specifically, perennials. So on our farm, we recently received funding to grow food, to experiment with growing food and building community. Specifically, we set out to grow some unusual fruit crops. Fruits such as saskatoons and aronia berry, quince, currants, elderberry, sea berry, and we've just added honeyberry into the mix. Well, what are these fruits? Saskatoon who? Aronia berry what? What are they and what do you do with them? Well, these fruits are high yielding, environmentally and grower friendly, and they're an exceptionally nutritional food source. They will blow blueberries off the antioxidant chart, and they taste great. You can eat them fresh or serve them alongside ice cream. They have a tart and also a sweet taste, a lot of these fruits do. So we also were like, well, you know, we already have a community of pears and apples and raspberries on our farm, and you know, we wanted to meet some new fruit neighbors. Okay, so you're into unusual fruit. Well, what does that have to do with with cultural regeneration? Well, the trick is not just to think about food and fruit, but how do you grow them in terms of function and how they relate to each other? So the key innovation in our project was the use of forest garden guilds as a design tool for growing food and building community. Well, some of you may be familiar with guilds or groups of people in a profession that work together to share skills and resources and ideas to expand their reach. Well, there's a wonderful agricultural tool called a forest garden guild, which is a perennial polyculture of multipurpose plants that create networks of mutual support. We break that down. Perennial, many seasons, polyculture, many of them, multipurpose, lots of functions, creating networks of mutual support. This is not a new idea, but an idea whose time has come. We can consciously apply principles of plant community function to grow into our home gardens and to our farms so that we can grow our own food, our fiber, our fuel, our fertilizer, our pharmaceuticals, and have fun along the way. So what I want to do is share with you a tool, offer you the tool of growing your own plant guild, and then thinking about guilds as a metaphor for your organizations and how you want to build and live in your community. So this is an example of the guild and the fruits I mentioned here today. And the first thing you want to do is observe. Pay attention. Get to know your place. Those of you who garden know it's the light, the slope, the water. It's past land use. Maybe it's your past organizational history. Connect to place. Get to know your neighbors. And now you want to, first and foremost, build soil fertility. An absolute tenet to organic agriculture, a healthy soil community allows for plants and people to thrive. So I'm going to show you. You don't even need a shovel. You just need a place on your lawn, and you just need a few materials here. Starts with some cardboard. I'm going to lay that on our lawn here. And then you could also add newspaper or coffee bags, whatever's on hand, and we're going to build up. So then I'm going to add leaves. You can add straw or chaff, add some fluff. Then you add in some manure. I left that at home. Don't worry. The Circus World Museum was closed where we get our elephant poop. So I left this. But you want to add a manure layer. Those of you with chickens, you can add that or get to know your neighbors through poop. I don't know. Okay, so now you can add some more straw. We're building up. And then top it off with some compost. And voila, let it sit through the winter. And you're creating a community for your plants to thrive. Now you want to start adding your plants in the form of fertilizers. And think nitrogen fixation. So on our farm guild here, it's sea berry, the orange plant up there in the corner. And these are plants that work in association with the bacteria to make fix nitrogen and make it available to the rest of the plant community. I think of an example in the plant world, again, seaberry, any of the bean family. Example in the people world or community level, there's a group in Iowa called the Value Chain Partnerships who have nested networks of local food marketing strategies where they're able to build a whole economy around local food for the whole state. Pretty cool. Okay, now we want to add a dynamic accumulator. These plants have really deep tap roots that are able to go deep into the subsoil, mine for calcium, magnesium, draw them up through their leaves, make them available to the rest of the guild. This is really cool. We don't have an example in the guild here, but we also have it in the understory. Things like Jerusalem artichoke, horseradish, they work really well. And I think these plants tell us to deepen our relationships. So, okay, I wanted to deepen connections with the grower community, especially women farmers. Just recently traveled to Nicaragua with a Just Coffee delegation to visit women coffee growers there to start an exchange program. The cool thing is they're coming to Wisconsin at the end of April and early May. Wow. So, okay, think deep, go deep in mind for those things that have meaning in our life. Now we want to add flowers. Pollinators unite. The world is not a sterile place, neither is your food. Create habitat for flowers to thrive. All these are flowering plants, currants, Saskatoons, you name it. Now we want to add an insectary plant. Now these are your risk managers. They're going to create beneficial habitat and an environment of inclusiveness. On our plant in this guild, the elderberries are a great example of that. Anything in the dill family, garlic, add those. I think of in the community realm, WORT, Madison's community radio station, run by over 350 volunteers. What a diverse environment and diverse set of programming they have there right here in Madison. And finally, food. Plant what feeds you. All of these are we can eat. Yes, some of you may wonder why or how, but I wanted to highlight quince. This is a tree that can live up to 300 years old and can produce up to 800 pounds of fruit per tree. Wow, we have 20 of those. That's a lot of fruit for a long time. But the point is, at the end of the day, plant and do what feeds you. So I think forest garden guilds have much to offer as a tool for a very practical level for growing food, but also as a way to live in community, both free and interdependently. Again, this is not a new idea, but an idea whose time has come and is taking root. Think about Detroit, a city who lost over half of its population and has more vacant lots than any city in the US right now. Farming, urban farms, community gardens, local food networks, entrepreneurship, self-reliance are thriving. They're taking the whole idea of forest garden guilds and redesigning their entire city. Wow, that's pretty cool. In Madison, we also have it here. It's here to stay. There's a group called Madison Fruit and Nuts that are working to plant diverse, like, perennial food in public places. Featured here, Troy Community Farm on the north side of Madison, and the design for the new Badger School. They're adding education into the list of functions. Wow, perennial landscapes to learn from. This is exciting. This is hopeful. This is not expensive. This is not a new idea, but an idea whose time has come. On my farm and in my life, forest garden guilds have offered us a way to expand our impact and our reach. It's enabled us to concentrate wealth in the form of health, happiness, and expanded ecosystem services alongside new business opportunities. Opportunities such as the Grower Exchange Program and the development of a new organization that we're working on called Just Fruit. And with it, the creation of a new story we've been noticing as we plant food and work to build community. And that is this whole idea of abundance. So I invite you today to offer your tips and help me co-create the conditions for a sustainable, abundant ecosystem. So I'm gonna pass around this tip jar, and I invite you to reach deep into the pockets of your mind for ideas, thoughts, and stories for creating those conditions for abundance. I'll collect later. I'll also post on our website, justfruit.org, for those of you who need to think about it a little more, that's fine. But the point is, as a farmer, it is my hope that you will share the importance of growing perennial foods and building long-lasting relationships. As a facilitator, it's my hope that you help me frame the questions, set the intentions, and co-create the and transform the story of food insecurity and scarcity that many people in Wisconsin, the U.S., and the world experience right now to a future reimagined story of sustainable abundance. Thank you very much for helping plant true seeds, one guild at a time, and feeding our future. Thank you.